Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition as we're creeping closer to episode 150, which I've not organized as of recording. I'm joined by the unpredictable jackal of Source Wrestling. It's Leo McLean. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So I'm looking forward to this. It's not often I have actually people into my DMs going, I'd like to have a chat. So I'm like, yes. Yeah. I always like when people come in because that means they've got something to say and they've got something to talk about. And that always makes for an exciting episode of the podcast. So it's not just me going, do you like The Rock? And they've got an answer to go with it. But the first question is always the same. It's the cliche podcast question for wrestling. It's, how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment you watched it? What was the moment that got you hooked into it?
Well, the first memory I really have of wrestling was my granddad. He was a big World of Sport fan, the old British, you know, like big giant haystacks. I think that was his favourite. I remember him talking about him so much. And it wasn't till a wee bit later, my mum's sister bought me a Hulk Hogan action figure. The classic ones that just went, that was it.
I think I had one back in the
day. She got me one of those and then that kind of hooked me more into it. But I didn't see much of it when I was younger. I think it was when I was about, 10 or 11 when we got Sky. And that's when we got to see WWF, the old Raw and SmackDown. And that really hooked me. Seeing The Rock and Stone Cold, they took on it. It was just, that hooked me. Couldn't get me off it.
It's weird. I find that now speaking to a lot of people my age now, because it was going either way when I was speaking to folk on this podcast. It was either someone a lot younger than me or a lot older, but we're kind of the same. I'm 31, so we're kind of the same kind of bracket of watching wrestling. It seems to be video games and wrestling figures. That seems to be the two kind of gateways into this thing of wrestling. Because I know for myself, I watched a little bit of it. I watched Heat. I watched the Inferno match, which I think is like 24 years old today from the first one. I'm like, oh god, how old am I? It's aged me terribly. And then after that, I didn't see much of it, but I got a Draws action figure, the old Bone Crunchers. Those ones, and that's kind of kept me going. Then I got Ken Shamrock and I got Gold Dust, and they all had triple threat matches, and they all did the Stunner, because. So it's weird how something, it's not often just wrestling itself brings you in, it's the accessories and the bits and pieces around it. So it must be weird watching Attitude Era, seeing The Rock and Austin, and not seeing this guy that you've got, this orange figure that you've got that does the bear hug action, and not seeing him at all. Because even if you got Worldwide or WCW, you're still not seeing him because it was NWO at that point as well. So were you like going, oh, I need to find this Hulk Hogan guy? Or how did you kind of, did you get tapes? How did you kind of get reintroduced to the pre-Attitude Era stuff?
Oh, for me, I think it was more my friend. He was a huge wrestling fan himself. He had all, I don't know how he was able to do it when he was younger. His mum used to buy him two of the same figure. One for him to play with, one he kept in the box. And he had a wall full of them. Literally, he had a whole room just for wrestling. And he used to have all the pay-per-views taped, VHSs all over the place, borrowed them every time just to watch them. And obviously, I had one of those old video players where I could record to myself. So I put that in, put my tape in, record it. So I give them back the next day.
Seems, again, with all this, like, all these things I've done now, always have a friend. We always have a friend that has everything kind of thing. I know my mate was the same. I was the one that didn't have much. I got a figure every so often, but my mate had the Elimination Chamber set. He had the Hell to Sell stuff, and he was, oh, it's so cool. And always cool going around his house and playing with, Johnny Stamboli, some random figures that they'd pick up. But tapes. It's like, it's weird that we glamorize this, but really, this whole tape trading genre of life, this wrestling world, it was just piracy. We were just
piracy. It was.
That's all it was. we kind of sugarcoat it by going tape trading.
Yeah.
That's still piracy. That's what it is. Again, the same. I just imagine being a kid and having the wherewithal to keep your figures in a box. I say that with all these boxed Funko Pops behind me, but, you know, I whatever years old, 13, I would have never thought of that. I would have been out of the box straight away, box out in the bin, because we did do recycling in 2003, and that would have been played with the whole time. So,
yeah. You especially couldn't help it if there was a weapon or a title in the box you wanted it, like, give me it.
Oh, I love the belts. I don't know how much of a figurehead you still are, but I remember when I was younger, you used to get the WWF belt, but for some reason, even in the Attitude Era figures, it was still the Winged Eagle.
Yeah, I remember that one. Yeah. The thing is, they were quite plasticky. They weren't very bendy. Mm-hmm. But my friend, he done a test. He got the one of the Windingles, because he had plenty of them, put it in his radiator for about 10, 15 minutes, took off, and it was flexible for good. I don't know how he done it. He must have melted it so much that it thinned out. So I tried that, and I left it on for too long.
Your friend's a renegade, I'm finding. Yes. But no, that Kurt Angle, of course, when he got balls, he had to take a figure, take out to the windowsill, window ledge outside, scrape it to get him to be bald, the plastic stuff. if I have a child and they do that, I would be absolutely furious, but I was quite happy to do it. But get the red pen, they're bleeding, get the red pen on them as well. So,
do you remember the figures that used to sweat? The big, bulky.
Yes!
Me and my friend watered down fake blood just so we could do that. Just press it and watch it pour out.
I had a road dog.
Yes.
Which I obviously took the little plastic bits off his hair, so he just had copper wiring instead. And a cane, because I need to find out if he had something under the mask.
Take the mask off, yeah.
Yeah, and it was all disgusting.
Yeah.
And I think I got an Undertaker years later as well. Oh, so
there was, yeah. But there's was there a Stone Cold? I think there was.
Well, there must have been. The one I remember I never got but wanted was Draws, because he had he had pants on his head.
I don't remember that, but now I want to see it.
All right, I'm going to double check just to make sure. Sweat. This is going to be weird. Draws sweating figure
with underpants.
I've misremembered, because he's not coming with pants in the box here, but I'm sure he did. Maximum Sweat. There he is. Oh, what a figure. Draws looked so cool. I'm so gutted that he kind of... I just got this figure, and then by the time I actually got to watch wrestling, he was not wrestling anymore for reasons. Oh, God, there's Kane as well.
Oh, someone's going to be on Amazon later.
Oh, if I could get away with that, I bloody would. I've got a child to afford now. But yeah. There was a Stone Cold. Came with the vest on.
Yes.
Anyway. So you got into Raw SmackDown. Attitude Era, who is your kind of guys? You mentioned Rock and Austin, but we've all got our boys. We've all got our kind of naff ones, the ones that we don't really want to admit. But who is your kind of favourites you loved watching?
Well, I was kind of like a sheep back then, so I loved the Hardys, Edge and Christian, the Dudleys. I loved them for the tag team division. But to be honest, one of my favourites, Godfather. I love the Godfather. It was just every time you see him with a woman, you're like, how does he do it?
That was the one that you can't have your... It's always the one that comes on when your folks come into the room or something. Your parents come in. It's always either Godfather, Rikishi, or just someone that you went... Or the cat or something. He's like, no, this is what wrestling is. Honest, this is not the whole... why do you keep coming into the room at this exact point where this is happening?
Even when the Sexual Chocolate came as well, it's like, Mark Henry, what the fuck are you doing? Oh, no.
Oh, yeah. I mean, thankfully, like I said, I just came into it properly just after things like Good Housekeeping. I didn't get to see China and Jeff Jarrett beating up Moolah, which, in hindsight, wasn't the worst thing in the world. But, things like that. Mae Young going through the table.
Oh, yes.
Good old days. Amazing. So, yeah, Godfather. Any other gems? I know Steve Blackman, I think.
Yes, he was. Definitely. It was every time I heard his entrance theme, it was like, oh, yeah, he's going to come and kick someday. But, yeah, Steve Blackman, one of my favourites as well as Viscera, when he was the big trench coat wearing, like Viscera. I love that version of him. He looks so scary.
And I know that, of course, Kwaku does ring announcing its source. I assume you've got that kind of that bond over Viscera. Yeah. I know he's a big fan of Big Vis. Bin bag and all.
Have you heard he's got an entrance music when he comes out to source?
Is it Viscera's Love Machine theme?
Oh, Teddy Long's theme.
Oh, of course it is. That makes even more sense. So I was just imagining Clarky coming out to World's Largest Love Machine.
Oh, I need to pitch that. That would be beautiful.
That's what there's not a source rule before now in this episode going out. Damn it, it could be a surprise. So your favourites, I like hearing like you're not your cliche ones, but Hardy's is always a go for me because they're my favourite, absolute favourite of all time. You've got like a tattoo of them, of their logo and all that kind of stuff. So I'm all in on the Hardys. Yeah. And Godfather, what a choice. I listened to your chat with Aaron Woods, of course, Cord to Woods. We'll give them a plug. You mentioned you quite like the cruiserweight. So I think that was more kind of the X Division, TNA kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But of WWF, right about that time, you would have had guys like your Essie Rios, Scotty Tuhati, I suppose, Dean Malenko. Tajiri, I suppose it was cruiserweight's always kind of something you gravitated towards. I mean, I suppose for the Hardys, the same.
Yeah. Well, being a small person myself, quite thin, I can't see myself powerbombing anybody. So the cruiserweights really spoke to me. And one of them, I'd say he was definitely underrated, was X-Pac. He was amazing. I loved how he worked. But Tajiri was another one. Even to this day, I've tried to do the tarantula. I can't do it. It's just hooking them and then it's like, oh no, I'm going to fall. But yeah, the cruiserweights, they always speak to me. It's little guys trying to be bigger than what they are. And that's relatable. I want to be known. I want to be everybody's go-to.
Weird thing about X-Pac especially, he's a guy that at the time, he looked cool, all that kind of stuff, but you never really appreciated him. And then now that I've gotten older and I'm going back and watching these old Attitude Era pay-per-views in 2000 and all that kind of stuff and seeing X-Pac, I'm like, oh, he was so good. It's a shame he never got the plaudits at the time. Yeah. He was always kind of just really annoying. And he was, but he was really bloody good in the ring at the same time. Same with Jeff Jarrett's another one for me. Like, I didn't get Jeff Jarrett at the time. Mm-hmm. I didn't like him. Because I watched TNA growing up as well in early years, and he was always in the title picture and just always bloody there. Mm-hmm. And then when you listen to him or watch it back, you go, there was a reason why he was always there.
Yeah.
Because he's very, very good at what he does. But TNA, though, how did you get introduced to TNA?
By luck. I was just channel flicking when I had Freeview, and there it was in Challenge. As soon as I seen it, I've never seen a six-sided ring before in my life. So I'm like, what is this? So I started watching. I was like, okay, this guy, AJ Styles, he's okay. And then watching him for years on, he's better than okay. But Suicide was one of the ones that really spoke to me because I always wondered who was under that mask. Then you later learn there was about six other people under it. So it's like, okay, but still, Suicide. He is his own person.
Did you have the TNA video game?
I had that. Right. I had that on the Xbox, yeah. And it's like, you are Suicide, if I remember correctly, but you had lost his memory, was it?
Yeah, that was it. So I don't know if you even created your guy. You were a first person and you got beaten up and you came back as Suicide. I never got past James Storm. I didn't even make it to TNA when I played it. I got to Mexico and I never got any further than that in the
same
game.
I couldn't either.
The graphics were incredible, but the gameplay I just could not work out. It was like five-star wrestling. The graphics are a bit dodgier, but you know, the concept of it all is like, oh, this is interesting. I'm rubbish at this. I'm just gonna go back to 2K. Thank you. Here comes the pain, you know, classics.
Yes.
So it's Challenge TV then. So that must be quite a bit later on. So that you missed kind of your proper X Division stuff. Then so I know they do a lot of stuff on YouTube and that. Was that kind of your haven for finding all this, like, because again, I know you mentioned Amazing Red and that in Burn to Wood. So was that YouTube you kind of got to him? Or he was about a little bit in the Challenge TV days.
Well, for me, obviously, I didn't have much internet access at that point, but I did have a used DVD shop not that far from me, and they sold a lot of TNA stuff. So I was able to find their old, like, the DVDs weren't that old. But now they're old, but I found a lot of them there. Started watching them all from that on. And like you're saying about Amazing Red, for me, I find him pinnacle to the X Division, because the stuff he pulled out was just incredible. I never knew what Code Red was until he done it, and I was like, it's like a modified, like, what do you call it? I do it as well. Canadian Destroyer. Yeah. It's a modified version of that, and when I seen how he done it, I was like, that is a thing of beauty. The way he would hit it with any sort of move, he just, every time I seen him, I was like, I want to see something, I want to see more of him, because every time I seen him, it was something new.
That was the beauty of the X Division. I mean, I don't know what it is like now, because I just don't watch TNA, or Impact, I should say. But that was the beauty of the X Division, where they had their finishing maneuvers, and they just literally came out of nowhere. They could, Petey Williams, you mentioned the Canadian Destroyer, perfect example. Anywhere, if you're bent over and he was running towards you, that's it. It could be game over at that point. Styles could get the Styles Clash on any position, wherever he was. Even Sabin with things like the Future Shock, and Cradle Shock. He could just pull out anywhere. It was so good. I love that you had a place to get these. I had to hope that eBay had them at a reasonable price, because there were always two disc monstrosities, and the cases were just ridiculously, disgustingly bad.
Yes.
Oh, absolutely. I've got not here, but my folks that are in their loft, I've got like maybe 10, 20 TNA DVDs, and they're just all flipped, the most horrible cases in the world. And
yeah,
I think at this point, if I take them out of the loft, all the discs will be scratched, because they'll just be falling out and just rattled
to dust.
But it was one of those I had to get, like Turning Point 2004. That was my first one. And that was the Elix Skipper Cage Walk.
Yes. I don't remember that.
As soon as I saw that was for sale on eBay, I was like, whoa, I'll be paying over the odds for this, because I have to have that in my possession. Because I originally saw it on the Wrestling Channel in 2004. Couple weeks after it aired live. I was just, the best thing ever. Raven and you had Raven Jeff Hardy on there. TNA's great. I'm glad that they're actually uploading some of their like 2000s stuff now on YouTube, like 2005, 2007. You know, there was proper excellent stuff on there. TNA, said Amazing Red. Of course, I assume you like his big brother Crimson as well.
I love that. I've got a similar idea to come for myself, but I'm just waiting for the right opportune moment.
Who else was kind of in about your TNA love?
I think Sanjay Dutt, he was there at one point. Yeah. He was there early. I remember seeing him. But then there was Rubik's as well. I remember Rubik's.
Wow, that is a throwback. Rubik's. I remember his look. And
it was so cool. It was the coolest full-on costume I've ever seen. It's like you're called Rubik's, like a Rubik's cube, but you're wearing a costume that's a jigsaw.
I was literally about to say, I was like, I remember he had a jigsaw mask, and it popped on my feed here. I'm like, yes. How did you go? Oh, I figured he is called Jigsaw, but they changed it to Rubik's when he was in the US.
Yeah.
Oh, that makes sense now. But that's just TNA all over. That's just wonderful that they went, no, don't know the difference in America. We'll do a jigsaw or a Rubik's Cube. You'll be fine. You'll be all right. That is an excellent shout. There are so many good ones, like Shocker. Remember Shocker?
Shocker, who's that? Oh, right, yeah.
He had a mask, but he came to TNA without it for some reason. And he just looked, I don't want to stereotype, he looked like a Mexican. Like, you know, if you see Shocker and you see like Psychosis when he took the mask off at One Night Stand, they just look the same. That's just your Mexican look kind of thing. Angry. And I think Psychosis got to put the mask back on, Champ, after he took it off, if I remember rightly, at One Night Stand, which was cruel. The X Division was just ace. And like you're saying, as a wee guy, as a skinny lad, like I was at that time as well, you look at these guys and go, oh, this is the, I could do that.
Yeah.
I'm not going to, but I could do that if I wanted to. So saying that then, when you were watching WWE, if you came back to that, round about that time, was like getting the cruiserweights, like your 2009-ish time challenge, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So you still had Mysterio, just.
Yeah.
Hanging on by a muscle thread. There wasn't that much weight. London and Kendrick, maybe they were about.
Yeah, they were.
Of cruiserweights.
Thing is, if I remember right, back then they didn't really use the cruiserweights as match material. It was more like some of them were comedy, some of them were just there to fill the card.
Mm-hmm.
I really didn't appreciate that when I seen it. I was like, no, they're not using them properly. Get like the cruiserweights out. They're just as good as, or if better than, most of the bigger guys. Because
mm-hmm.
bigger guys, well, high up in the card, they're there. Some of them didn't really do much since they've made it. But then there's guys down at further bottom that are trying to get up there, but not getting the push they need.
Remember, I think 2004 was a proper good time for that kind of thing, because you had like mm-hmm. Jamie Noble and you had Chavo Guerrero, of course, who again another one who was wholly underrated at the time. And I went back and watched, and went, oh, this guy was so good. I don't know why I disliked him so much. Hurricane, Ultimo Dragon. Even though he fell to it, I had him as an action figure, it was the coolest figure ever. And then I watched WrestleMania 2000. It got a little bit less cool when he fell over twice his entrance. And, you know.
Still funny.
It was ace. But no, it was such a cool action figure as well, because he had mask and all that kind of thing. Have you always watched the wrestling as of from that point? Or did you ever have an extended break? Or did you kind of think you were too grown up, too cool for the wrestling, that you took a step back?
I think the only break I had was really when I had the Hulk Hogan to when I had Sky, but then obviously Sky disappeared later on. It was like periods, but as soon as I found TNA on Challenge, from then on started watching it like mad. I don't really watch Raw or SmackDown much. I watch the pay-per-views more
because
I prefer pay-per-views. They still give you the backstory later on, like before the match, so at least I know I'm not missing out too much. But I just didn't really have much of a break. It was more every month, expect the wrestling.
That's the beauty of WWE. For all their faults and everything, I can miss Raw and SmackDown every week. If I stay up for the pay-per-view or the premium live event, as it's called now, I'll stay up and watch that. And they give you all the backstory. I don't need to watch. I mean, I'll still hit bits and pieces. I'm actually more in tune with watching more clips now, weirdly, since Cody Rhodes has come back. And I never thought that would be the case, but I'm just interested in what they're going to do with Cody Rhodes, and I just want to see it, because I didn't watch AEW, I wasn't that interested in it, but now that they've got one of the guys from AEW over back, I'm like, what are they doing? Are they going to have him just do all this cool stuff, or is he going to come out and be boring a week? It's like, no, it's just been amazing every week. I never thought I'd like Cody Rhodes, but you know, that's the thing. Yeah, you can skip it and then you just watch the pay per view. So. Are you still Impact then? Do you still catch that? I don't know what's on in the UK now. I don't know where you can watch it, if you can.
Not as much, no, unfortunately. The occasional times I'll see it on YouTube, but not much. It's like wee small parts, no matches, just, you know, clips from a match, which is annoying, because I want to watch just one full. I don't care who's on it, just give me a good old TNA match.
So when you came in, was that... the Six Sides ring was still there, so...
It was just before Hogan.
Just before
and
Hogan.
Eric, yeah.
So 2009 to 2010, of course, because Monday Night War returned for 3 weeks. And but then you got things like Aces and Eights, you know.
Oh,
some amazing stuff there. You got Garrett Bischoff and Wes Briscoe.
To this day, I still didn't believe that it was Bully Ray. I was like, no, there's somebody else there. He's pretending to be this guy. It has to be. But... it's because I think it was one scene he actually gets hit with the hammer. I was like, how can it be him? He took a hammer to the head. How is he the president? It doesn't make sense to me.
That's the thing. I think it's because it was so just mad who was being revealed. It was like, one week it was D'Lo Brown. And then And then it was Devon Dudley, of course. Brother Devon, he was revealed. And then Mike Knox.
Oh.
Doc Gallows. Turned up, and then of course Wes Briscoe, who I just can't believe he came from the lines of Gerald Briscoe. I've seen Gerald Briscoe in a dress, and I still can't believe Wes Briscoe was King of the Ring 99, for people that are curious if they want to go check that out. 2000.
I don't want to remember, don't please. That was terrifying.
For anyone who's listening, you will need to go find the hardcore evening gown match between Pat Patterson and Gerald Briscoe, King of the Ring 2000. Enjoy it. It's a feast for the eyes. Actually, there's a banana at some point. So yeah, it will be a feast for the eyes. Was it Pat Patterson that used a sanitary towel as like a Mr. Socko? Anyway, right.
That's a good dance.
That was like my second ever VHS, like bought from a shop and everything, and that was the match it was on. It was like, this is the best. Wrestling is amazing.
Oh god!
There's not much we can really discuss more about that, so we'll just kind of move on. Everyone, just go check it out. Kennel from Hell, add that to your list as well. Right, so we've talked about your journey watching wrestling. Let's get into your journey actually becoming a wrestler as well. So. How aware were you of like Scottish wrestling or British wrestling in general? I know you said World of Sport, of course, Giant Haystacks, but by the time that you started properly getting into wrestling, it was not that feasible. You maybe got 1PW possibly in places, but that was about FCW as well. But how aware were you of a British scene before you started training?
I wasn't aware whatsoever until I did hear about ICW. I think it was back in when they first really started in Maryhill, I can't remember the exact year. My friend, she used to go a lot, and I heard about it and never went to the early stages. And then eventually it started growing even more. Started watching it on YouTube, seeing what they were like. I still didn't go to any shows until my friend, he started training at Source. And I went to his debut, seen a couple of shows afterwards. And then... sadly, when the passing of my granddad, on the day of his funeral, I seen Source were doing intake classes, and I took that as a sign that, yeah, let's go do this. And that led me to it.
So I'm thinking about 2012, something like that. So that's just when they're doing the My Channel stuff, and that's how I would have seen it on YouTube as well, because I was aware of ICW. I think Insane in the Membrane. Was the full show they had on. I think some people spliced other episodes together to make the full shows. So again, we got in around about the same time with all Scottish wrestling stuff, so that's fine. It keeps my timeline right in my head. So your granddad passed away, of course. Big part of you being a wrestling fan as well. He introduced you to it, I suppose, and now... it's weird how things work out with timings and things like that. Because in the same kind of vein, my wife's family, it's weird that... Oh, I've got a notification come up. Care of that. When someone passes away, like, the same day, maybe years down the line, that's when someone is born in their family. It's just so weird how that works out. And I think in our case, I think she's pregnant at the moment, but our child's due like the day that her granddad passed away. It's just weird how things work out like that. And you probably at the lowest points of your life, and then you see the wrestling and you're like, now or never, got to do it.
Kind of thing. That's what it was, yeah.
So when you saw ICW for the first time then, was there anyone that kind of caught your eye that you want to see more of? So 2012, so she'd be like, I don't know, Grado, Jester, guys like that.
Jester. It was Jester. He was basically he was the poster boy, really. And I thought to myself, I was like, he looks like a big scary dude, but he also looks like he knows he can handle himself. Mm-hmm. And then the more I seen of him, I was like, yeah, he can handle himself, special with that big corkscrew. Yeah, I'm not messing with him. But I've met him once. He's actually quite nice.
That's the thing. I don't want to spoil Jester for anyone, but yeah, I've met him a couple of times. He's just really nice, and it's weird. Again, I'll throw my wife under the bus, but he's her favorite because he looks scary, and then when you meet him, he's like, "How are you doing? How are you doing? Are you doing all right? That's fine. Oh, I'll sign this for you. No bother. Have a good night." Like, no, you should be terrifying at all times, please. that's what makes wrestling so cool, though. When you see these things. So start at Source then. Again, I'm covering ground that you did with Aaron. This is my podcast, so I'm going to make you repeat it again. So the first session, I heard it was like the worst. How was it like being introduced to this is wrestling?
The first introduction was the walkout at the start, and for a full week, I was feeling it. My body was stiff. My bones were killing me. It wasn't the bumps or anything. It was the workout that did it to me, because I was not prepared for it whatsoever. Even though my friend did say, if you see a deck of cards, pray. And I thought, what? A deck of cards? What? I'm doing wrestling training, not going to the casino. I'm like, okay, fair enough. As soon as it happened, I was like, right, now I know. I'm praying. I have now got a god. But after that, it eventually got tolerable, not easier. So whenever we see the deck of cards, we all still have the same, oh god. But after that, it became a lot easier to expect it.
Bit of PTSD every time it turns up. Go past a casino and go, oh no.
Just get the Vietnam flashbacks.
Not the Nine of Hearts. Not anything but the Nine of Hearts. So yeah, you came in, you didn't feel like you were prepared, and afterwards you knew you weren't prepared. Did you do any like sports of that beforehand, or was this just kind of going into this cold?
When I was about 10, maybe 11, I did do karate, but that didn't last long. I got really close to the head sensei. Me and my family all liked him, but then he left. It didn't seem right. I didn't enjoy it anymore. Didn't get far, but as soon as I stopped, didn't do any other sports. I wish I did. There was plenty of sports I could have picked from, but I wasn't really a sporty person. I was more of the brooding goth in the school, just sitting in the corner with all my mates, just talking about anything, see the wee Neds passing by, shouting at us, mad goth. That's what we are.
you're in the crowd and in the four corners in Glasgow.
Yeah.
I hear about this every time I go. I don't know whether every time I go to Glasgow they've just scattered. I don't know if it's just too sunny, but you know, every time I go I hear about this, the Goths gather, and I have still yet to see them. I've only been to Glasgow a couple of times, but
I was 15, we used to all hang about inside Glasgow Central. They didn't mind us hanging about, and there was a whole group of us. You couldn't move, but there was a whole group of us. It was either there or Georgie Square. For some reason they stopped both, and now they've all migrated elsewhere. So it's like, I remember when I was young, I had a bigger place than this.
It's just just gather, get the tannoy up, and just do the first chord of first piano tune of Black Parade, and then they all just swarm. I did hear though, and again we were speaking to Annan, that you did a bit of backyarding, or we all did. We did that a bit of backyarding. Yeah. Did you have really a gimmick?
Not really. I just for me, it was just more about doing the moves I loved. So a lot of rock bottoms. I don't know why I loved the rock bottom. It just really spoke to me, that move. And the more I've trained, it's like, nah, I'm not a fan of it as much anymore. I'd rather do something flippy.
It's a nice easy one just to do on the grass. So always in my head, I was always like, I want to be Jeff Hardy. However, I didn't have the coordination to actually do the flips. I would jump off stuff, but I wouldn't do the flips. I would just like land. I would do it like you see big guys try to do splashes and land on their feet first and then splash. Yeah. That's how my style was. Which wasn't great. When I was younger and I was like 10 stone, nothing. And I was like going, I'll do this big swanton and then just go land on my feet.
Splash. Yeah, actually, you're reminding me there saying like, how easy it is to do it in the grass. That was fine. We always had that one friend who would drag the pissy mattress. You're like, no, get that thing away. I am not bumping on that thing. Get it away. We'll take the concrete over that any day of the week. Just get it away.
There's a reason why it's being thrown out. It's either pissed on or it's got the springs sticking out of it. There's no other reason why there's a mattress here.
That's it. Exactly.
So yeah, you did your first couple sessions then. I was again just on the bits I've read and that and listened. A couple of years of training. How did you find just your evolution? Did you find it was slow and steady wins the race kind of thing? How did you find the training in general?
Well, when I first started, I just came into it not even knowing what my path was going to be. I just came in, thought I'd learn how to wrestle, seeing the different styles, grappling, your technicians, and then obviously seeing like Robbie Wishart doing the backflips, everything for your lucha. I was like, I still don't know what I want to do. Because I was going more technical. But then thought a small guy trying to hold a lock wouldn't really work much. So then I moved on to just doing a bit of lucha, and that seemed to fit me perfectly. But it took a long time before I decided that. I think it was 2.5, maybe 3 years into training. Now I was 4 years before I debuted, so I had just that year to try and zone in on my abilities, even though it was COVID year, but still I tried my best.
People found weird, wonderful ways to make sure they still learned and trained during that time, which we'll talk about, because even though it was only kind of half getting out of it now, it's still a very big subject in the world of just wrestling in general and life. But I suppose during that time then you became this kind of hybrid, which leans to the unpredictable jackal persona, that you can, if needs be, if you've got an opponent your size or smaller that you can do, you can wrap them up a wee bit. You've got bigger guys, you can do the high flying style. You've got a little bit of everything in your arsenal.
Yeah.
Did you find that was beneficial then, even though you had to eliminate what your kind of straight main style was going to be? Did you find that was like advantageous that you kind of picked up all these little bits of other styles along the way?
Yeah. In fact, I think it was when I had a conversation with Robbie Wishart. We were discussing my style, which being high flying luchador, but I kind of liked some submissions. He showed me a few. For example, when I do my head scissors, I can put them into an arm bar. I was like, that works. That's something you wouldn't expect either. Just getting a head scissors done, like, oh, wait a minute, oh, boom. So working on how to make my moves work with moves I like works well for me.
Was there anyone that he kind of pushed you to watch? Because I'm thinking for that kind of thing, you likes your Eddie Guerrero, maybe your TJP, I suppose, when he was manic as well as suicide. Yeah. He was suicide for a little bit as well. So there's plenty of, and that seems to be quite a style that's quite common, I suppose, on the independent scene. Unpredictable, yes, because you can do moves everywhere, but it seems that kind of high flying into technical stuff. You see that quite, it's GIF. A lot of GIFs. That's what I'm basing all this on, GIF wrestling. It's just cool moves and a bit effective. Was there anyone in particular that Robbie or anyone kind of pushed you to go, maybe check out this guy for some inspiration?
Yeah, Robbie, he definitely told me a fair few. He gave me one that actually led me to someone else that he didn't mention. Didn't know of him, but as soon as I watched him, Vikingo, he is amazing. I seen him on TNA. If you're going to look for him, it's Viking, but with an O at the end.
Oh, sorry, I've heard the name. El Hijo del Viking.
Yeah. I don't remember his whole title, but it was a TNA match he was in. And once I watched that full thing, I just couldn't believe him. He'd done so many amazing things.
He looks incredible.
He is.
That's amazing. I can see where some maybe the bit of the face paint and all that kind of stuff. You've kind of been a little bit inspired through that.
Slightly,
as well.
Yeah,
that's ace. Well, bear that in mind for anyone who's listening after you've watched the evening gown match, Viking. You might need that just to, like, to bleach your eyes to see that afterwards.
Yeah.
So a bit of Viking. So again, that kind of gets you back into your Impact Wrestling TNA kind of stuff as well.
It does,
which again that kind of. You see, AEW kind of promotes the flying stuff, and then WWE is your showman, sports entertainment. Impact seems to has that kind of middle ground of, it does this the story stuff, but you do have that kind of hybrid style kind of stuff at the same time, which is nice. Like I said, I really do get back into it because I hear nothing but good things about Impact. It's just time. that's the biggest issue. It's time and finding it, which used to be the issue. And because I'm Scottish, I refuse to pay for anything if I don't have to. So I'm going to sign up to Impact.
Same.
I've got WWE Network, but that was just more out of necessity because I'd used my mate's one for so long that he decided to watch Royal Rumble last year like an absolute dick. So I had to go and order it myself.
Yeah.
And I just haven't bothered to stop it now because £10. It's just ridiculous value for what you get to see. I can watch Wrestling 2000 whenever I want. If I so wished. You're gonna end up watching it now. I'm gonna mention it so many times. You're gonna stop and go, right, we're watching King of the Ring 2000. I need to see it now. I need to watch this and just get it out of my head. see Crash Holly against Bull Buchanan at all the clubs.
Oh, God, yep.
I'm pulling you into it. You're definitely going to watch it now. I'm just having it. Bit Kurt Angle having two, three matches a night. You know, it's just, it's worth it. It's going to be worth it.
I've literally just written that down.
So again, you had that big kind of first break because of the pandemic, but you had all that training. You kind of settled on what your style was going to be, started to build on that. Of course, you did a little bit of you know, as all good wrestlers do, they do a little bit of refereeing. They learn a little bit of that as well.
Yeah.
How did you find being the referee helped you learn?
Well, my main concern was the crowd. Mm. I was nervous about being in front of a crowd. My very first time I'd done the refereeing was actually sprung on me. I was prepared to do the ring crew. Next minute, the coach at the time came over and said, "Do you want to ref for the night? We don't have anybody." I was like, sure. And as soon as I put the ref shirt on, got outside, I was still nervous. I was nervous till probably the second match. Then from then, every time I'd done it, it got easier, but behind the curtain, I still got nervous. Till I got through, I was fine. And all the way up to my debut, it's just been the same. Still get nervous behind that curtain. I'm not scared in case, I'm not scared of the crowd. I'm just scared of embarrassing myself in front of the crowd in case I trip on the rope or something. Quacko will tell you, one time I did do that. I think it was a Leafling show I was refereeing. He was out warming the crowd up in the second half. As soon as I came through, stepped my first foot through the rope, my other foot went under the apron, not even realising. So when I stepped through, it hooked me. I literally hopped towards Quacko, stopped, stared at him like, "Hi." You didn't see that.
Wrestling's weird. It's like, the one time for an hour or so you can be a bit, you can do all these silly things, because folk will just go, "That's just part of the show. It's fine." Yeah. Rarely, because I've seen it happen otherwise, that the folk are going to come up to you after the show and go and just like laugh in your face, going, "Ah, you fell, you did that there." And still remember I went to a show that the big butt, it was Rudo it was WrestleZone, but he won the Rumble, and then he beat the champion and came out with the belt, and folk were absolutely fuming, fizzing, and I thought, "All right, that's fine, show's over though, so that's all right." Came around the corner on my way out. For some reason, Rudo was there, and this old geezer was squaring up to him, shouting at him that he was going to fight him and all that kind of stuff. And it was just nuts. And Rudo was just there. He was calm as you like, going, "Yeah, mate, the show's finished. Go home. The show's over now. You can leave." And it's just, and you watch it, it's going, "Oh, that's just wrestling. It's wrestling all over." It's just like, it gives you all that emotion, but at the same time, "No, once the show's finished, Leave them alone." they need to clear the ring. They need to do all the stuff that's not part of the show. It's like going to a concert and you see, name a band. And then after you see them outside afterwards and shout at them, going, "Well, you didn't sing this song. I'm going to fight you." You're looking and going, "Show's finished. What are you going to do? Go away. Leave me alone." So as far as refing goes, was there any particular like big matches, big wrestlers that you got to be in the ring with that you got to see up close and personal, that you maybe not have, we have never thought you'd get in the ring with? Because I know Source bring in some, they brought in some big names.
Yes, they have. But there's actually one very recently. I refereed for Clyde Valley, Eric Young.
Oh.
I got to ref his match.
DNA guy, that's up your street.
The thing is, when we were just before, the interval, he was going to do the take pictures with the kids and that. He's standing back there waiting, and I seen him holding the TNA tag team title. I was like, "That is such a nice title." He's like, "Oh, it's a hassle through the airports and everything." He went, "Do I hold it?" I was like, "Sure." So I was having a look at it. I was like, "This is amazing." So I'm standing talking to him, my hands, when he was listening to me, I was listening to him, I was going, I had to swap plans. I was like, "Oh, this is the heaviest title I've ever held." And then when he came out for his match, he wore the white mask and everything. And I was like, "Oh my God, this looks amazing." Gets in the ring, takes his hoodie off, seen his back tattoo. I was standing there for a minute going, "Oh shoot, I'm reffing." I was just admiring his ink on his back. I was like, "Wow." And this whole match was, I was invested even as a referee, watching the match, reffing the match. Yeah, I'd be fully invested. It happened to be probably the best match I've reffed.
It's so weird seeing Eric Young nowadays, because for us, we'll remember him as Don't Fire Eric, Canada, Super Eric. I loved Super Eric. I don't care what anyone else says. Super Eric, Sharkboy, Curryman. Yes, please. I will have all of that.
Favourite Eric is when he started losing his mind, trying to lock up everybody. I just love that. It's just, you'd see him stand at somebody and just go, you're like, oh, he's got to lock up.
Oh, it's just, yeah. Oh, Eric, again, that guy is wholly underrated in wrestling in general. Mm-hmm. I mean, for me, I don't think he was ever going to, he was always kind of stigmatized when he won the title TNA because Daniel Bryan won the title. Yeah. Like, Daniel, we won't call him. Won the title a month before and he had a beard and an underdog story. And then Eric Young won the title a month later with a beard and an underdog story. Yeah. And that was it. But, again, just old school TNA. Eric Young will always have a wee soft spot there in mind. So you do refereeing, you still do it, a little dabble, just to keep an eye on the competition.
Yeah.
Keep an eye on them just to make sure, just to work out the weaknesses.
Yeah.
Up close, that's not a bad plan. But you broke out this year.
February.
I just wrote down 2022 in my notes because that's how prepared I was. So you made your actual in-ring professional wrestling debut against David Devlin.
Yep.
That was part of the Resurgent shows, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yes, it was.
Night one.
Didn't write that down because I'm stupid. So I was like, actually, you said you're anxious. That's just being a referee. Mm-hmm. And that's, people don't often look at the referee in the crowd. But now you're going to be front and center in front of the crowd and they're going to be watching you. So again, was anxious? Was that just like trebled 10 times, 100 times before you actually?
It was. I had a few people in the back trying to calm me down because I was panicking. I was pacing the whole night. I couldn't relax. And then all it took was hearing Kwaku announce me because I asked him to make a wee joke just to calm me down. I said, can you see this? So when I was standing backstage, I held Wayne in tonight an astonishing 200 feathers. I went, nah, okay.
That was it. Relax.
Yeah, they helped me. And then I heard my music and I was like, yep, full on mode. Went through, effort just felt like referee mode in a way. Professional. No, like, being like who I am. I am Leo McLean. As soon as I stepped through a curtain, that's me.
I don't know if you've ever watched Lemmy, but when I heard you telling that story or heard it happening, my first thought was just let me show what weighs more, a ton of feathers or a ton of steel.
Yep.
And it's like, steel? Because it's heavier than feathers.
And then they actually do the weighing.
Yeah, no, but no. No wonder, because look how many feathers there are. That's loads of feathers. It's unfair. but yeah, just popped into my head there. Add that to your list of people. We're giving you a list of loads of things to watch. Yeah. Like, you know, evening gowns, you know. I'm gonna see a screenshot. You're gonna put it on Instagram later or something. I'm gonna see you watching this, and they'll be like, ha, "I did that." So it was the match itself. So you're going against David Devlin. So of course, that's someone who's trained you, someone you're very familiar with. So at least if you're gonna be anxious at all after you go through the curtain, which you said you kind of went professional mode, at least you got someone there who knows what you can do and you know what they can do. How did you find your first match?
I rather enjoyed it. Even though he kicked me a few times that hurt so bad, it was just a match I'll never forget. I've heard people saying when they have their first match, they remember only wee bits and bobs, not the full thing. I don't know what it was. I must have been too much alert. I remembered it all. And everything for me just went perfect. I just remember hearing my friends just in the corner cheering me on. And when I got my hand raised, I heard them screaming like mad. I was like, yeah, this is it. This is what I want. And if they can do that, I could probably get all the crowd to do it. So the first match, perfect. Enjoyed it.
Excellent. And then, of course, you're on the second show as well. So you had a whole, you're throwing this at the deep end because you're going to someone with the experience, David Devlin. And then, I mean, if you thought the kicking was bad with David, then you're in the next night with Luke Matthews, who
yes,
I think he's a kickboxer. Or at least he's well trained in using his feet. He's got that old educated feet thing going on. So first night, elated, amazing first match, happy with it. Second night, in with Luke Matthews, so someone a little less experienced than David, but still someone who's been around a little bit. How did you find
Matthews? Well, I think Luke Matthews does his homework, because the moves I used in David that worked, I tried to use on Luke, and every hold I put on, he reversed it like that. I was surprised, shocked, even put me in a move I wasn't put in before. If you ever see the match, I'm just like, what the? I'm trying to work out how to get out of this thing. Since I figured out, he turned it around, put in more moves. He does his homework, and as you said, he's a very kicky person. The first kick he got to me was on my thigh. Didn't like that. I tried to kick him back. He blocks it, kicks me in my back. I land on all fours, and the crowd in front of me literally heard me saying, "That sucked." I just couldn't believe it. I was like, "No, that really sucked." Then he gave me a Spartan kick later on. He gave me a claymore. I've never been kicked so much in my life, and I hope never to get kicked again.
So does that also lean into your to being unpredictable then? Because you had your first match, you did all the moves, it worked. The second time, tried to do the same moves, didn't work. So now you're finding ways to kind of mix it up and throw out some curveballs and all that, all those other kind of cliches to keep them on your toes. Excellent. Right. So, and then our match, I've got, we'll just finish up your matches and then we'll kind of dot about a bit. Was representing Source against Edinburgh Wrestling School. So you were teaming with Stone Malone and Hal Rayner.
Yes.
Against the guys at Edinburgh Wrestling School, run by Joe Henry, which I didn't write down because, of course, why did I? Awesome Rob, Sharky Fossil, Judas Gray.
Big Chez, I believe.
Big Chez, of course, is. I'm speaking to Mr. Manivel in a couple of days. I really should know that. But yeah, so Big Chez as well. So that's a bit different then. So you've had your first two matches against experienced, like, guys that have been wrestling for a number of years. And then this six man, I suppose you had Stone and Hal, who have been wrestling on shows for a wee while. And then you've got, I guess, a team who's maybe had a handful, maybe less than five matches, maybe between them in total. So how was that as an experience in general?
It was rather surprising, to be honest. Sure, I had two more experience than they did. Hal, obviously, he tried to become the team captain, as we'll say. But the fact that they were not as experienced as my partners, together they became a unit. They really worked well together. And I'll admit, I kind of did the thing that Napoleon says, never underestimate your opponent if they're making a mistake. I made a mistake. And that team, they worked well together. Mm-hmm. Me, Stone and Hal, we could have worked better. We could have been more together for each other. But they had something. Don't know what it was. They've obviously probably trained together before in the past. We were put together, so we didn't know much about each other. So I think that's the reason how they got the better hand.
I suppose Stone and Hal were coming, because we'll talk about like some of the pandemic stuff in a sec, but yeah, they were coming from a different school. They were kind of still kind of acclimatizing themselves to Source and Source ways. And whereas the guys at Edinburgh, pre-pandemic, during the pandemic as well, they were all kind of geeing each other up. And even though I think it may have rubbed some people the wrong way, they were putting out promos, hyping themselves up and doing all this work to bond and all that kind of stuff, which clearly worked on this occasion. You've seen our guys from Edinburgh popping up, like your Ryan Richards and what have you. So it's certainly seems to be working. So outside the wrestling end, we've done that. We've spoke about that. We've got some questions coming in, so we'll... And then we'll do pandemic things. So we've got a couple of questions in. We've got Katsabella. A nice question here. What is the story behind the face paint?
Oh. Well, there's two different stories. If you look at a jackal, their face is different from all the others, with their fur looking different. So I have my own fur. But the thing is, sometimes I'll just be me. You won't see anything. So that's Leo. Sometimes I'll have half of the face paint on, half Leo, half the Jackal. So we're both in my head together. We're working together. But if there's something I can't handle as Leo at all, you'll get the full-on face paint, which is full-on animal. So it's that is the unpredictable state you don't want, because he will terrorize. In other words, he won't give up.
And she also added, and if you could have one thing, would you have a tail or ears of a jackal?
Ears. Because then I'll be able to hear anybody behind me.
Ah, good try. I was going to go for it. I personally would have for tail, you know, extra limb.
If I went for a tail, I would be chasing it for hours on end. I'll end up tiring myself out, and then it's an easy 1, 2, 3. No, thank
fair,
you.
Fair enough. You've blown my argument out of the water there. No, that's fine. We've got Paul Fitzpatrick. He asked, what is your favourite wrestling move to do and why?
The Canadian Destroyer. It's just one of those moves that always spoke to me. It's not just your typical pile driver. Because me picking someone up for a pile driver won't work. So if I flip over them, it gives me momentum. Mm-hmm. And driving them straight down, that's it. There's no way you're going to kick out after that. I know firsthand what it's like to be on your head.
I'm just ashamed that it's so many people decided to use it. And it's just, it's one of those moves when we started watching TNA, it would have been like, oh my God, this is the most mental thing I've ever seen in my life. I mean, you can see Abyss getting choke slammed into thumbtacks or drawing pins, as we say here. We can see all these crazy stuff, but you always come out going, that one, Pete Williams, Canadian Destroyer.
Yes.
Best thing I ever seen.
Best way you ever done it, I would say, was he done a springboard, done a full flip, landed right into it, and then done it. I was so stunned by when he done that. Because I can't front flip. If I could, I would do it that way, but no.
I think the one that pops into my mind is it was against AJ Styles. And it was pretty much, it's Panama Sunrise. That's what he did. But yeah. It wasn't the Panama Sunrise at the time. It was just like, he just jumped off the second rope, Brett's rope, most dangerous rope, and just into it. And then that was it. I was like, oh, that's the best thing ever. Give me more AJ Styles versus Pete Williams. Now, he's backstage. Yeah. Get Pete Williams out. Give me Williams versus AJ Styles one last time.
One last. Come on,
Vince. Buy TNA so we can have TNA one night stand. I'm all in. You've got enough guys on the roster to do it. Rude, Bobby Roode's there. Lashley, McIntyre. You got plenty. That's kind of what I've done. 2K22. I've tried to do TNA Impact, and I'm just picking up the guys that I've already got on the roster on the WWE. So I can't wait to get Rikishi in the Banzai pack, you know, Junior Patu.
Yes.
For his,
I'm for that.
His 2 weeks, the reverse battle royal, which he didn't really want to take part in. And then, was there a backstage fight the week after, maybe? And they went into the toilets and he was on the toilet.
I think so.
This is like 2010 or something like that, maybe. It was Hogan era, I'm sure, when they started bringing in some weird ones like Val Venus.
May have been. I'm foggy for that.
Add that to your list. That's. I don't know how you'll find it. I don't want to know how you find it.
Toilet scene.
Kishi toilet. No, maybe not. I'm sure it is. I think it popped up in as you heard Brett's rope, I was, and you acknowledged it. You're fan. You know of OSW review. So I think they pulled up at some point in their TNA arc. So in their Black Rain episodes, Black Rain. Loved him. He doesn't love Black Rain so much, but you know, he was with Relic. It's killer spelled backwards. So last question I got here, we kind of had a off recording chat about it. You don't want to go in too much on it, but I'll ask it anyway. Tyler Mortimer, he was at the Source Wrestling School showcase last week and saw what went down. It's often, thankfully, as an undiscussed area of pro wrestling. Can you touch on the experience of injury in the ring, how you dealt with it, and what happened, and how you get back in the ring after? So answer as much or as little as you want from that question.
Well, as to the injury itself, things happen. We all know the rule. We're gonna it's eventually going to happen. You're in wrestling. You're not, speaking of JR here, it's not ballet. It's, you're going to get hurt. So that's plain and simple for that one. What was the rest of it? How did I handle the injury?
Yeah, how you dealt with it? What happened? We can miss that one out. And how you get back in the ring after? So, how you dealt with it? How it's affected your confidence? How you feel about getting back into the ring?
Just listened to my doctor. Told me to rest up. That's what I've been doing. Getting back to it though, I'm very anxious. I really want to get back into the ring. I've went to a few classes just to sit and take notes, but I'm really wanting to get in, and hopefully very soon I will be, and I'll be coming back not just with the training that I'm going to have, but triple it. I'm going to work even harder than I have, because I've got a lot to prove. One thing's not going to stop me.
Good, because the worst thing that can happen is it rattles you entirely, and then that's you all done. But no, that's good to hear. So we've got questions that we ask. I'm sure you probably pre-warned. We asked two stupid questions that everyone...
I watch them. I watch you. Don't worry. I know these ones.
Oh, great. Have you already... you've had an answer prepared on these
Most, yes.
Okay. So first one then. What's your favorite dinosaur?
An Allosaurus. It's basically a bigger version of a T-Rex, but its arms are longer.
Ooh.
So it's like... It's what the T-Rex should have been.
That looks amazing.
Yeah.
My Google search history has been wonderful this evening. That looks ace.
Yep.
Allosaurus. There you go. That's fine. And other question, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Believe it or not, I YouTubed that. There's a YouTube video.
whoa. Right, okay.
It looks like it's under a tree, so you can see it.
Versus one. We'll just put two sheep versus one cow, see where we get. Oh, it's come up with best of the SWM podcast. There we go. incredible. Cow versus sheep duel. Watch what happens. There's the tree. This is wonderful for everyone.
This is my answer. As soon as I seen it, I was like, yep.
And there's the... Yeah, cow! You're down!
They both go down, but then the sheep gets up.
Yes!
So, if one sheep can do that, two of them can do it.
Brilliant. That's fine. That's settled it, guys. That's it. The question's over.
Yeah, it's on that.
We've got it. A sheep beats a cow, so two sheep's going to beat one cow. Done. Well, I mean, I was going to end the podcast in June. I don't need to now. I've already got the answer to the question that everyone knows. So, I mean, that's fine. I can just...
Sorry, guys.
We're done.
I've done my research.
I appreciate you've done the research. It's nice. So I did hear you do watch and listen to the podcast, which is very nice. Thank you very much. At least it counts for one listen. is there any particular episode highlights that you kind of go back to that you'd recommend to anyone else after they've listened to this episode?
Alexander Darwin McAllen's. I love his, especially when he speaks about the Dean Ford.
Oh, I was so excited to speak about the Dean Ford.
I was killing myself for that. Yeah, I thought it was just the best comeback ever.
Oh, it cracks me up to this day. I mean, because sometimes I end up, because I try to do some splices for best of clips, it doesn't happen because I'm just like, just watch the whole episode. Just this best of bit's fine. Go watch the whole thing. But yeah, that photo, I think I still have it saved on my laptop. So every time I see it, it just cracks me up. Dean Ford and
put it as your background.
I don't know. Next episode. We'll be very confused. I've got Johnny Reeves next, so we'll be very confused why I've got Dean Ford in the background just doing this the whole time with these kickboxing titles and what have you.
Don't tell them, just do it.
So how often do you remind Luke Matthews of that? Or were you thinking about it at the time when he was kicking you?
I've done it a few times. I think that may be the reason for the kicking, but yeah. I've known him for a lot of years beforehand as well, but that was gold. It's the best ever comeback I've seen.
So we mentioned the pandemic. We're going to kind of get into that a little bit. So of course, you're two, the bit years in training, three. And of course then.
Yeah, I'd say three because I don't count COVID year.
Yeah. And then pandemic happened. other stuff happened as well, which we will not, no point speaking about that because, you know, don't need to dwell too much on it. How did you find yourself? How did you keep yourself occupied? Where was wrestling kind of the last thing you want to think about because you couldn't do it? Or did you just train, study, join these online classes that folk were doing? How did you kind of cope during that time?
Well, the first couple of weeks, I think like most everybody did nothing, just chill, relax. Eventually it did start eating me that I'm not in the school, just training or being around the source. Just, it didn't feel right. Then obviously, I can't remember who it was, decided to do Zoom classes, just do the card walkout with each other. That helped me keep active. And then in the source like group chat, we all started sending links of like different things. And I once asked, I was like, could I actually see some people's like debut matches? Some of them sent me theirs, watched them. Then I started like looking at different other wrestling like schools, FCW, Pro, no, Pro 2 because I wasn't till later, Respect, Reckless Intent, started watching more of their stuff and just studying really more the opponents in case I ever do need to be in the ring with them. I know what they can do. And also watching a wee bit of other like foreign companies, so not just studying for them, but more studying their moves, seeing if I could use it myself and can adapt it into my way of wrestling. Let's see if I could do their DDT from other moves perfect.
It's a really interesting way to go. So yeah, as you were watching these matches, not just for picking up moves, but yeah, scouting as well, because you know, there's always a good chance if they're wrestling at FCW or at Pro 2, that there's a good chance they may appear at Source or you may appear at Pro 2 and what have you. So it's that's not something I hear people do, which is, but it makes so much sense to do at the same time, because then you're not waiting for the match graphic to go up and, oh, you're facing Una Raw. I'm going to go and find out what Una Raw does. But yeah, I've already done it. I've watched W3L Wrestling Showdown.
He would kill me. He would throw me about.
He is a big, strong boy.
He is.
And he's getting, I spoke to him around about the start of all this podcast stuff, and he's just gotten bigger and stronger, and it's quite terrifying to look at now.
He is the personification of evolution, but from weak to stronger.
It's just, it's insane. But he's like, built like a Sultan, but you know, he could just batter you at the same time. It's just, terrifying. So is there anyone in that kind of clump of matches you're watching, seeing these debuts, scouting your opponents for all over the country and beyond, is there anyone particularly you're like, I need to get in the ring with them? That's someone I need to get in the ring with in the next, as soon as possible.
Well, I did have a goal of going against Robbie Wishart, but obviously he's retired now, so that's away from me. There is two from Souls I want to actually go against. Jack Ripley. I would love to go against that young man. And Scott McManus. He's another one I want to literally be in the ring with, because I feel like me and him could have a good wee competition. Outside of Source, let's see. Oh, well, Freddie Fanboy's not about anymore, so that's a wee bit upsetting, because he knew how to make me laugh, even if I was in the ring with him. If he made me laugh, I would have a lot of respect for him. Who is that?
You like someone who kind of matches your style, like maybe like Omar Muhammad, a Conor Malloy, or that kind of thing, or do you want to get in someone like just a big dude, even
well, for
if
start,
ADM or something?
Oh God, no, no ADM, no. It may happen one day, I don't know, but I would like to start off with people my size and then gradually go up, just so I hate to use this reference, but. For example, Dragon Ball Z, one of my favorite animes, the character Goku always goes, he tries to meet his level with this other person and he gets better than them. Then he meets somebody better than them and keeps going and going and going. So in a way, I want to see myself doing that. Go with someone my size and make my way up. Maybe one day I'll go up against Andy Wilde, which would be too much, but still. I just want to see myself do it.
So would he be your kind of final boss kind of thing, or have you got like Jack Jester maybe, like the company? That's how you started watching Scottish wrestling, and that would be the final boss level.
Yeah, in the Scottish scene, I would say so. Yeah, I think Jester is my the peak of the mountain for me. But until then, work my way up. I have to.
And it's the same companies, just as wherever you can get to.
Whatever. I want to try and stay in the UK just now, just home myself and get better. And if someone over abroad sees clips of me and wants to book me, I'll happily accept if I feel like I'm ready at the time. If not, I'll just stay home until I'm ready.
Excellent. So I think we've pretty much covered everything we need to, and my cold has caught up with me just as we're wrapping up. So excellent timing. So I apologize to anyone for those coughs in the background as it kind of wraps up. But before we go then, dream match. We do a little bit of fancy booking. You get to choose the main event, whether it's WrestleMania, Wrestle Kingdom, whatever AEW does. Bound for Glory. No, that's not the big one. Slammiversary.
Bound for Glory is the big pay-per-view.
Slammiversary is always the better one, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
Ed King of the Mountain and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It was way better. You're in the main event. You get to pick your opponent. Any match stipulation. It could be opponent, opponents, anything. Mm-hmm. What would it be? Make them alive. That's the only kind of stipulation I've got.
Yeah. A three-way dance with myself. Definitely Amazing Red back in the 2010 days. And AJ Styles from the same era as well.
Oh, nice. Unbreakable feel.
Yeah.
Excellent. And you'll be Daniels. Actually, yeah,
I'm kind of.
That's fine. I mean, I'm the same. It's just it's just what happens.
My girlfriend puts it a nice way. My health's thinning.
I find annoying. I have a full head of hair. However, it's really so blonde at the top and thin that you kind of see it. But there's no bald spot. There's nothing. This is all hair, and nobody believes me. I have to go touch it, and I don't want to do that now in post pandemic. I don't want to shout at people, touch my head, because that just sounds weird. I think I'd be canceled.
What could be worse? If you don't believe me, rub my head, rub it.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah. That's a lot worse. So, in a weird way to wrap up, as you go and watch King of the Ring 2000, where can people find out more about Leo McLean on the social medias?
Oh, 1 second, I've got this written down because I am bad with blooming.
I did wonder if you'd have it prepared this time.
After the last time, yeah. I seriously, when he said that, I was like, thank you. You can find me on Twitter at Leo McLean PW, the L and M, the L's M and the PW's caps. And then Facebook, I had that written down as well with the writer. I wrote it here, if I remember correctly. I should have just written a bit of paper and kept it beside me. That would have been a lot easier.
Professional would have done what Aaron did and had it in front of me, but I don't. Hang on. Let's I can do this.
You're doing the same as Just look me in Leo McLean on Facebook. That's the best way to do that as well.
Easy. Excellent. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today. I knew, even though I've got like 5 lines of notes, I knew we would have a good chat, because like I say, if you contact me to be on the episode, I know you've got a story to tell, or at least you're going to fill the time. You know how this works by now. I've still been burned by the one episode where someone contacted me to fill in and they zoned out when I was asking questions. That still haunts me. But no, I've loved this episode. Thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.